here very close for our final main hall speaker, who I'm sure needs no introduction for everyone in this room. Dr. Firuz Nadiri has an exceptional over 30-year career with NASA. And as you've seen, he's incredibly generous with his time. I personally have had the opportunity to work with Dr. Nadiri to see how committed he is to the Iranian-American community and the Iranian community globally. So the title of his talk is From Shiraz to Mars, No Dream is Too Big If. One thing Dr. Nadiri wanted to share that I wanted to say here is that he had an asteroid named after him earlier this year in March. So one of, I think, the coolest fun facts we've heard from our speakers on the stage. Please join me to give a very warm welcome to Dr. Firuz Nadiri.
Thank you. Thank you. Hello, everyone. Hello. Wasn't that inspiring? Yeah, which goes to tell you that even in the most dire circumstances, if you put your minds to it, you will succeed. Let me first do a sound check. How many Shirazis in a room? All right, I thought it would be more. You know, in the past 3 years, 3 days, I must have taken 500 photographs with people who say, "Oh, Dr. Man Shirazi, can I have a..." So. Great, great. Yes, you can, yeah, there is a line for green card for Shiraz just outside here. In the past 3 days, you have heard from, some amazing experts about some many important aspects of entrepreneurship. You have heard from Kamran Elahiyan, Farhad Mohit, who have walked the walk and imparted words of wisdom to you guys. Since I'm the last speaker on the last day, I thought I'd do something a little different. So I thought I'll take you to a journey to outer space, specifically Mars. And the reason that I do that, really, is to show you that even with some of the most challenging undertakings, when there is a will, there is a way. The speaker before me, you saw that, the commitment to a cause here on Earth. I want to... just to be a little different, take you to outer space with me. So, in fact, going to Mars is, to state the obvious, is in fact pretty complicated. So, since 1970s, we, the Earth people, have sent 55 spaceships to Mars, and well over half of them have failed. Right? And so some people say, well, what's so difficult about Mars? I mean, wasn't it 50 years ago that we landed humans on the moon? So what's so much more difficult about going to Mars? Well, for one thing, is the distance. And it is a lot further away. And I want to, is there a clicker here? Okay, all right. I guess, is it a green button? Alrighty. Okay, so let me give you a sense of how much we all see the moon, particularly Shirazis. They have a glass of wine, sit down by the moon, and you know, they tell poems and all of that. And so we have a sense for how far moon is from the Earth. It's really right there. And when we send humans to Mars, you can joystick a lot of the commands. Mars is a lot further away. I want to give you a sense how much further it is. So the photograph that you see behind me is an iconic image that the Apollo 8 people took when the crew took when they were going right over the moon. So that's how you see the Earth if you are at the vantage point of the moon. Now let me show you another image of the Earth. This time, this one is taken by an Earth rover, by a rover, NASA rover, sitting on the surface of Mars looking back at Earth. And contrast the two images, this one and this one. This is how you see Earth from the surface of Mars. So it really is quite, quite further away. And by the way, the distances are quite a bit. It takes, if you send a command to Mars, it takes about 10 minutes just to get there, and if the rover wants to respond, another 10 minutes for the thing to come back. So let me tell you how we go to Mars. So what you see behind me is Earth and the Mars going into their respective orbit around Mars, around the Sun. Every 26 months, they get reasonably close. Well, if you call 50 million miles close, they get as close as you see in this image behind me. And so most people think that, okay, so why don't we do this? Why don't we wait until the 26 months when the two planets are very close, and then we just make a run for it? Well, it turns out, energetically, that's impossible. It takes a lot of fuel, and when you have a lot of fuel, the rocket can't lift you. So it takes a lot of fuel to deorbit from the Earth orbit that quickly to go to Mars. So what do we do instead? So what we do instead is the figure you see on the right. We don't send a spacecraft to where Mars is at the launch time. We send it to where Mars is going to be sometimes in the future, and hope that the spacecraft and the planet come together at the same place in deep space at the same time. So for those of you who follow football, and most Iranians follow football, you see that you don't often pass the football to where the player is. You send it somewhere different and hope that the ball and the players, they get to the same point at the same time, and then the player can dribble the ball and go forward, except, you know, in football, if you made a bad pass, it's just a bad pass. The game goes on. Here, if you misfire and you don't send the spacecraft to exactly to the same place, to the same location where Mars is going to be, you have lost $800 million of a spacecraft. And NASA doesn't like that. So this, of course, takes a bit longer. You see, you travel about 500 million kilometers as opposed to 50 million kilometers. But the way the astrodynamics works out, it requires less propellant. Just to give you a sense, because Earth is going that way anyway, when you launch something, it takes the momentum from the Earth, and it takes much less energy to get to where it wants to go. And it takes about 8 months. So the journey from the Earth to the Moon takes 8 months. That is if you navigate everything precisely. So I want to give you a sense for when I say navigate it precisely, what does that mean? So let me bring it down to something that you're most familiar with, and you know, in our Earth life, and let me give you that example. So it is, if I scale it, if David Beckham in Cairo shoots a ball and lands it in the goal exactly in Wembley Stadium in London. So that is the kind of precision you would need in order for the spacecraft and the Mars to come together at the same time. And if you're still not impressed with that, okay, what about if I have the stadium in Wembley Stadium move at about 100,000 kilometers per hour? Because Mars isn't just sitting there for us to throw our spacecraft at it. Mars is traveling, our spacecraft is traveling, and the two of them have to meet just exactly, you know, at the same time. And so that's difficult, but as difficult as this is not the most difficult part of the journey. Okay, it is not the 8 months and getting the spacecraft to Mars. That's not what kills you. What kills you is the last 7 minutes. And we have come in NASA to call it the 7 minutes of terror. And why? It's because after you have traveled most of the 550 million miles and you're really next to Mars, gravity of Mars get a hold of the spacecraft and just pulls it toward itself. And when you're about 130 kilometers above the surface of Mars, and by convention, we call that Martian space. not that there is a sign that says welcome to Mars, it's just a convention. You get to 130 kilometers, you say you're in Martian space. And anyway, you get to that point, traveling at 21,000 kilometers per hour. Okay, let me say that a bit more slowly. 21,000 kilometers per hour, and you're only 100 kilometers up from the surface. And unless you find a way to slow this thing down, you have to design the perfect tormoz, if you will, right, to slow this thing down, you're going to crash land on the surface of Mars. And in fact, just 2 months ago, a European Space Agency spacecraft that was trying to land on Mars crash landed on Mars. So not easy. So the question here is, how do you stop something that's traveling at coming at you at 21,000 kilometers per hour, and you have 7 minutes to get it all done? So the way we do it is we have designed really the best brake system possible. First thing that we do, the atmosphere of Mars is much thinner than Earth. It has about 1% of the Earth atmosphere. That is very thin. But even so, when you're traveling 21,000 miles an hour through an atmosphere, even 1% of the Earth, the friction slows you down a little bit. But it comes at a cost. It gets very hot in front of the spacecraft. It gets about 3,000 degrees. And unless you give it a heat shield, the spacecraft is going to burn up. So the first thing that you do, you have to design a perfect heat shield that will slow you down from a hypersonic velocities to supersonic velocities. Once you have done that, then you can open up a parachute. And parachute further slows you down. And then when you get closer to the surface, you fire up some retro rockets. And that slows you down some more. And then finally, you are at the height of a maybe 10-story building. At that point, we inflate, pop open an airbag. The spacecraft is inside the airbag. Right, and then we cut the cord, and we allow this bag to fall on the surface of Mars, and it will bounce like a basketball on the surface of Mars some 17, 18, 19 times, and finally it comes to stop, and then we deflate the balloon, and out from it comes the rover, if everything works out okay. So I want to show you a little video clip, hopefully it will work, to just show you how this process works. Of course, this is a simulation, right? There is no CNN at Mars observing all of this thing, right? So this is a simulation, except we have weaved into it that night where we were at JPL waiting to hear from the spacecraft. And we knew that the spacecraft had landed 10 minutes earlier. We still wouldn't know whether it landed perfectly or not. We're waiting to hear the radio signal, and you'll see the reaction in a room. When finally we got a radio signal from the rover that this process, all of it worked, that we had landed, and that the airbag had deflated, and the spacecraft had come out. So let's see if we can show the video clip.
Side up. that's no science analysis because it looks like nothing I've ever seen before in my life.
Thank you. So you saw the emotion in the room. To give you a sense, the way the celestial mechanic works, 5 years ahead of time, you have a 21-day window that you have to get your spacecraft ready and launch it in that 21 days. If you miss the 21 days, it's not like, okay, we'll do it next month or maybe, you know, a few weeks later. It has to be in that 21 days. And so 5 years before that 21 days, you have to have perfect planning to get the spacecraft ready to launch. And then there is the 8 months of travel, and then there is 7 months of terror. And then so you are all, we were all in that room that night, very tense, not knowing whether 5 years worth of work would work or not. I must tell you, there was maybe a little bit additional pressure on me personally. Because NASA had failed in the previous two missions before they named me the program manager. And so I had two sorts of pressures on me. One from NASA, that I knew that if we failed for a third time, I wouldn't know what would happen to NASA. You know, the budget would be cut. And, you know, so there were a lot of pressure just to succeed for the agencies that I worked with. And then I had this other dreaded feeling that if we fail, the headlines next day in the Los Angeles Times or the Global Press is going to be NASA failed for a third time, and this time it was being led by an Iranian American. And I thought not only NASA would fail and I would fail, I would also let down a lot of my compatriots who had taken a certain level of pride for us doing that job. But fortunately, it worked. So next, 8 years later, there was time to be using a term from this conference. There was a time for disruption. We decided to land another rover, a much more capable rover that you could take a lot more instruments with it to Mars, but it would weigh five times as much. The rovers that you just saw, it weighed 200 kilograms. And you can see me next to it just for a scale. The one that we were going to land, and that was in 2004, so the bigger one, we landed in 2012. And the spacecraft weighed a ton, 1,000 kilograms. And there was no way to pack it inside the airbag anymore. We couldn't build an airbag that big and survive the landing. So it was time for a disruption, and the people at JPL devised a new landing system, and it's very ingenious. It looks actually crazy, because when we first proposed it to NASA, they said, get out of here. There is no way you guys can do this, right? And so we named it Skycrane. As you will see, rather than an airbag, there is a sky crane that lowers the spacecraft to the surface at the end of a rope. It's a little bit more James Bondish than the one that you saw. So let's take a look at how that one went. This is now August 6th, 2012.
We are in powered flight.
This is a Skycrane.
We're at altitude of 1 kilometer descending. Standing by for Skycrane. Skycrane has started.
Single to us, you remain strong.
Touchdown confirmed. We're safe on Mars.
Yeah!
So that was our dream. We worked at it. It wasn't easy. And it came to pass. So one of the things that I wanted to chat with you is, what about yours? How big is your dream? It doesn't have to be going to Mars, you know, establishing a company at your age. That's big. Creating something from nothing and creating value, that's big. Having the courage to walk in the uncertain path, which is the definition of entrepreneurship, that's big. But you can see if there is a will, there will be a way. But the path forward is not certain, right? So the thing about entrepreneurship is that if you're expecting to travel a path that's paved and is traveled by others, if it was so, then other people would have beaten you to your dream already. Okay, so by nature, the thing that you do in entrepreneurship is that you create the path. I like that phrase by Rumi on the top, is get started in your journey and the way will present itself to you. Right? I love that. That is, to me, the definition of entrepreneurship, that you are not afraid of the fact that there is no Google map that it says it's going to take 48 minutes to get from this point to the other point, and you take Highway 405 and then you turn right. You don't know any of that. Okay? It is your courage and your commitment and belief in yourself that makes you start on a path which is fairly uncertain. But that being the case, that means there are going to be surprises along the way. There's going to be failures along the way. I want to share two of them. In this thing that you saw, our landing, there were many, many stressful moments, many failures. I want to share with you two of them. Okay, so the first one is we're a year out from the launch, and we were going to test the parachute. And we took it on a helicopter, we took it to in a desert, and we deployed it to see whether it deployed. Look how it went for us. Oops. Okay, let's try it again.
Go, baby. Here we go. Beautiful release. We have this massive structural failure.
So if this would have been, if this would have happened on Mars, we would have been dead. And this is about a year to go, and we don't have a parachute that works. Right, so you can feel the stress building in a team. Now, the next thing, the next one I want to show you is that the airbag. We thought, okay, if we hit the airbag and it hits certain pointy stone, it's going to rupture the airbag and destroy the spacecraft. How do we know that the airbag will survive the landing? So we decided to build a simulated rock and drop an airbag on it and to see whether the airbag will survive the landing. And this is what happened on that one.
And we drop. The airbag comes down, it hits the ramp, and as it's bouncing off the ramp, you see this huge gaping hole in one of the airbags.
Yeah, so the question is, so what do you do? You know, it is... You're a year to launch. You don't have a parachute that works. You don't have an airbag that works. Stress has built in a team. And what is it that you do? Well, there are times where you feel that you're spending a lot of energy working long hours, but it's not like you're, you know, floating in water. It's like you're swimming into cement. And a lot of people in your team are going to hit both a physical and emotional wall. And so your job as a leader is to try to figure out how you get collectively the team to get out of that and stay with it. And then, you know, and then the question is, what is the thing that works? Well, this does not. You know, early in my career, I would try this, and no namaz-e-jum'e or nothing, works in these cases. So the other thing you might say, okay, so as a founder or as a project manager, I'll just work harder. And so you say, if 60 hours a week is not enough, I'll work 70 hours a week, right? And I'm here to tell you that's not the solution, okay? When you are leading a team, either as a founder of a startup or later on when you're building up, and or as we had about 1,000 people working on the project. That's not gonna save you by you just working harder. Okay, for me, I can, finishing up, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about what has helped me through my career, what I have built my success on. It always comes to the team. Really, I wanna tell you that whether you're doing a project as complicated as Mars or when you're starting up a company, your biggest task is to win the competition for talent and put a team together that's first rate. And then find a way to mold the individuals into a team, to inspire them, to motivate them, to incentivize them, and to facilitate their work. So if you had 3 more hours in a day and you're behind schedule and you're wondering what am I gonna do with those 3 hours, I wouldn't spend the 3 hours doing individual work as a program manager or a project manager. I would spend those 3 hours on how I can facilitate the work of my team, because there are 1,000 of them. And those 3 hours that I spend making it easier for them to work, it is highly leveraged. If I work those 3 hours on my own contribution, it's only 3 hours. And the other thing that you need to be very careful is that all good teams, they need a few superstars. Superstars are individual performers. They have egos. It's all about them. And your job as a coach is to be able to mold them into a team. Now, most European football clubs have figured this thing out, and they excel. And we have seen, unfortunately, in some cases, like Iran national team, it doesn't succeed in big stage because it is a collection of very good people, but it's not a team. So for me, anyway, when people ask me what's been the secret of your success, I've been fortunate enough to work with amazing teams and have been able to make it easy for them to perform. Now, 2 or 3 last slides. Since I retired from NASA 6, 7 months ago, 8 months ago, I guess, I've started working with some startups, and I see the spectrum of personalities with the startup founders. Some, it is the entire motivation is how can I maximize my own equity at the expense of my team. So they're very stingy with how they give shares to their teams, because they see if that's the way they would maximize their own equity. On the other end of the spectrum, I see people that say, okay, if I incentivize my team through equity, the pie is gonna grow and my share is gonna grow. So the thing to do is not just to be thinking about, I have this little pie, how can I make it into little slices so that my slice is the biggest. So you have to have empathy and loyalty for your team. At the end of the day, and I heard this thing, from various experts in the past 3 days, is not the ideas. Carmen keeps saying ideas are dime a dozen, it's the execution. Well, who's gonna execute for you? It's your team. Take care of them. Be loyal to them, right? And so I also want to give you the other side of the coin, is that the loyalty sometimes should not blind you to be a tough decision maker. Let me show you one slide before I wrap up. Take a look at this image. How many people are working in this photograph? Two, right? And so it can be argued that two other people potentially are supporting the work of the other two. But what about the fifth guy? Not only he's not doing anything, he's adding to the load of the people who are working. And don't waste a day. That's not the time to have loyalty. You know, you have that kind of a person would have a morale issues on your team, and you need to get rid of them quickly. So of all the things that I could have shared with you, I chose the concept of team because I thought that has worked for me anyway, and I think that's the pillars on which you will build your company. So let me summarize with my last slide. Going back to the title of my talk, No Dream is Too Big. So long as you run from what's comfortable, you forget and safety and embrace uncertainty. You look at failure just as a stop point, as a stage in success. You realize for you to win, your team needs to win. So do not optimize based on maximizing your equity at the expense of your team. And you will succeed if you realize for you to succeed, and this is a key point because many of the people here come from technical background. And we, as technical people, we have a tendency to think that's the most important aspect of the job, and we're very good at it, we're comfortable at it. When you're working with other people, be it 5 people, 10 people, or 1,000 people, okay, the sociology of your team and learning how to master that and master the job of management and leadership, something that I hear from our folks coming from Iran, that Iran has no mudiriyat at all. At the end of the day, it's not that you are the most brilliant astrophysicist physics major or computer science major, is you as a leader, as a founder, as a coach, as a program manager, learn to how to have the social skill to manage your team. At the end of the day, you win and you die with your team. So with that, thank you very much for spending 20 minutes with me. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nader.